Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you at this time thanking you for all that you do in our lives. We ask you to give us strength to face today and tonight. Be with these commissioners as we do the people's business. These things we pray in your holy name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Bill. I'd like to call the second meeting of February 2012, Alamance County Commissioners to order. Welcome, everyone. It's good to see you all. The first item on the agenda is the approval of the agenda. We do have one change. Item number 10, closed session, needs to be removed from the agenda. The information that the commissioners were going to discuss is not been completed. It's not prepared for further discussion at this time. Would like to ask the board if there are any other changes or questions about the agenda. And if there is anything on the consent agenda, which includes the approval of the January minutes, that need to be removed from that consent agenda. Are there any comments or changes from commissioners?
No.
Hearing none, we'll entertain a motion for approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Tim, second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Very good. Next item is public comments. We have three individuals wishing to speak before the board tonight. I would like to first call and recognize Sheriff Terry Johnson. Sheriff, welcome to you.
Thank you, sir. I was late, could not get on the regular agenda. What I want to talk to the commission about briefly is what appeared in the Alamance news about that the sheriff had problems down in South Carolina not packing lunches and stuff and moving people around had something to do with our numbers being down here in Alamance County. And I took it upon myself to contact the other sheriffs or some of the other sheriffs involved, and you have a copy of all this, in the 287G program. I'd just like to read the last paragraph of the from Sheriff Mecklenburg County, who was the first 287G program in North Carolina. To give a one-day snapshot of the decline, I pulled the numbers from this date in 2008, 2009, 2010, and 2011 to compare to today's immigration population. Those numbers are as follows. 2008, 92. 2009, 82. 2010, 61. 2011, 47. 2012, 7. Sheriff Randolph County, who has works and does the secure communities, and also when they have people, they come to us if they're detainers on. And, of course, he gave the numbers on the back, but I'll give those first. 2008, 447, 2009, 418, 2010, 279, 2011, 252, 2012, 20. And he says, I've had my staff research your question concerning immigration numbers as far as contact with Randolph County law enforcement, and the following information was given. The starting of the year 2008, our numbers have steadily declined as to foreign-born arrestees. The numbers from 2008-2012 were all researched and was determined by numbers of arrested individuals and confined inmates in our county jail versus the number of total individual arrests and totals of confined prisoners. It should be noted that the overall arrests and housing have risen during the same period of time, talking about local inmates. I was also provided the statistical information for the Immigration and Natural Relations Service, and their numbers support the same trend as following. As to the reason for the current trend, I feel the answer is the closing of plants in ours and neighboring counties and availability of jobs has caused these individuals to move for economic reason. Last but not least is a sheet from Ms. Carla Winkle, and this is where they keep up. This is National Sheriff Association and one of the 287G's programs in Tennessee. And it's from Jessica Vaughn of handles a lot of the immigration stuff out of Washington. Hi, Carla. You may know some folks who would be interested in this statement from ICE on their plans for 287G task forces. It was forwarded to me by a reporter with a national newspaper preparing a story. In light of nationwide active...
Sheriff, let me interrupt you. I think that's written on each of what you distributed to us.
Yes, sir. That's fine.
And to be fair to everybody, what I would suggest... Because what you're also talking about is an update to the 287G program in
That's
general,
great.
Not just finances, but in terms of numbers and national trends. And it may be helpful, Craig, if we can maybe get something together for the March meeting. And I say that because if this is a discussion point, it probably needs to be on the agenda. There are others that may want to come here.
I agree. I think we need to.
Okay. That is certainly fine. Okay, if you will notice, at our jail, we're holding 44 federal and 35 ICE inmates as of today, and that's a whole lot more than the number one program in the state, which was Mecklenburg County and some of the others, including Wake. I talked to Wake. Their numbers are down.
Thank you, Sheriff.
Thank you. Yep.
But again, there may be others, Craig, that want to hear about this topic more than just the finance part of it, and I think to have it publicized and on the agenda would be appropriate. Everybody's okay with that?
We'll have a chance to respond to these comments at the end of the year.
Oh,
you mean after the rest of them?
Yeah, that's what I'm talking
about.
Okay.
Sure. I'd like to ask and welcome Eddie Hsu to come forward. Eddie, welcome to you.
Mr. Chairman, last meeting they were talking about the roads. Got to be this, got to be that, and showed some pictures from off bad roads. One thing concerned me out of their whole thing, and I spoke while y'all were in closed meeting or something, Jason, about it, and he said it was included. It traditionally in the South, and I don't know about the North because I don't hang around up there, but in the South, a lot of times people with a lot of acreage. Their kid will get a chunk, their kid will get a chunk. He told me once two kids get a chunk, they come under this. Now, there ought to be some provision in there for that type of situation. I know ambulance, the sheriff and all need a good driveway to get in, but the expense that could be incurred by private individuals under this type of deal would be enormous. I've seen all good drivers, what I would call a lane, you know. Now, they may need to say that every 400, 500 foot, you need a pull aside in case an ambulance mess up and come in. But there ought to be something in there that if a person had two kids or more and was getting on in years and wanted their kid to have this chunk and this chunk to build a house. It all not cost them a gazillion dollars to do it if they were back off the road. He said they would be under. Now, you can ask him, but he told me, you know, I was talking to him then. And I don't know if any of y'all are familiar with the, I don't know who lives there now, but the park place out in Graham Hopedale. Once you cross the little bridge in the bottom going out towards Hopedale, you turn left. They have a bridge. Is that bridge going to have to be 12, 18 foot wide? And that's an expensive proposition. I don't think it was well thought out. And before this thing gets up here, maybe you could speak to them and they could put it in that individuals with acreage shouldn't come under. They're not sub-developed. And certainly, a lot of these, I know, politics. I can remember when they started that thing, there was a gazillion promises on how good them roads was going to be in there. And you know what you got coming in off, I guess it's Turner Road, now one of them. When you come in that way, it's horrible. The last time I was in there, of course, that's been some years. But that was a development. And I can see making somebody do something about that. But a family getting stuck with what could be I mean, good gosh, to engineers and everything else, that could be a chunk of money.
Eddie, thank you. Let me just say a couple of things about that. There is a public hearing about this matter in our March meeting, but also, and you did the right thing in talking to Jason, I've had other folks comment to me about concerns, one of them very similar to what you just said about the family acreage. And Jason is making notes on all this and taking it back to his board before that public hearing. So I would encourage you to make sure he has written feedback on what you just said so he can address it with his board. Because what we saw wasn't the final ordinance. It's subject to the public hearing and them working on it for another month.
Be sure to be here that night, too.
But he didn't seem real receptive to me, but maybe if I put it in writing, I would have.
I think you should.
You'll be able to talk more that night when they have having that public hearing also.
Appreciate your time.
Copy it to his board chair of the planning board.
Bill Griffin.
Appreciate your time.
All right. Thank you, Eddie. And we have Mr. Harold Hargrove. Harold, welcome to you, sir.
Thank you.
Please come forward.
I'd like to thank y'all for this opportunity, and I'm in the same feelings of this fellow over here. For the ones that don't know me, I own Hargrove Construction, and I've been building in the rural area of Alamance County for 30 years. I do custom work. I don't build in housing developments. And this road provision ordinance that y'all are fixing to look at, I want you to get that package and understand the burden that it's going to put on our citizens in the rural county. Because I've talked to the planning department, and I pretty much understand what they're talking about doing. And I've called the DOT and talked to them about the Class 2 road provisions. And according to them, it's a Class 2 road is a 20-foot right-of-way instead of an 18-foot right-of-way without pavement. You have to have, and if you're going to require engineering and get it certified in order for the county to take it over, it's just like this fella said, it's going to cost a tremendous amount of money. And our grandchildren and our children, we're not going to be able to leave this land to them for them to access if you own a 10-acre piece of property with a 1,000-foot driveway going into it, because it's going to cost you about $150,000 to $200,000 to put a straight road in without bridges, without culverts, without any kind of, and then it's going to cost the builder, because it's going to take months for this to be passed or finished before they can get the lot to build on. In this depressed economy we got right now, the builder don't need any more burdens to carry. The homeowners don't need any more burdens to carry, because the banks are not lending money now, and I'm struggling trying to keep seven people busy in my company. Like I said, we do all of our own work, and trying to keep their house payments made, and it's taking 2 to 3 months to get a house through the bank now, much less putting 6 more months on getting a certified road put in. And y'all need to understand real clear what this package is going to mean to the citizens in rural Alamance County. Now, developments is different. I can understand developments where a piece of property is bought for a subdivision. But whenever you're talking about this ordinance passing and there's one driveway going in, it's considered a subdivision whenever you take another lot off that driveway. Then you're going to have to bring that driveway up to these Class 2 standards. It's going to be a tremendous expense to the whole family. And I do appreciate y'all listening to me, but I want you to get this package, read it, and understand what you're fixing to throw on the citizens in the rural part of this county. The subdivisions, whenever people go in to make money on subdivisions, that's what they're doing. They know they're going to have to put these streets in, but if you want to give your grandchild a piece of property, he's going to have $10,000, $15,000, $20,000 to put a 500-foot driveway in before he ever starts building his house.
Harold, let me ask you, did you say you had this conversation with Jason?
I didn't get to talk to Jason. I talked to the girl that was there. Jason was in Raleigh today. I called it okay. The planning department.
What you just said and what Eddie has inferred is I had a lengthy conversation with someone that said exactly the same thing that you did. I think Jason is receptive to listening and taking the ideas back to his board. I would encourage you this week to schedule a time with him.
Okay.
He's got a brother that used to be in banking.
I do. Dave Hargrove is my brother.
Oh, he looked just like you.
Well, thank you. I don't know. I think he was a good fellow. So I'm going to take that as a compliment.
You tell him I asked you about it.
I will.
You called me, and I called you back, and I owe you another call, and I'm glad you're here tonight, so I won't have to return that. Mm-hmm. But Jason did call and talk to me. He's been out sick.
Yeah, okay.
And he told me that he thought they were receptive to being different with what you're understanding. And so, again, Eddie, and you need to talk to him.
But you're taking the word private out of a driveway when you turn it into a Class 2 road. You're talking about a road. You're not talking about a private driveway. I will be there. This is my livelihood. I built 2 spec houses in 30 years. I'm a custom builder, and this will kill me. And I'm keeping 7 families fed in my little construction company and struggling. So... go ahead and kill it if you want to, but
what Tim said is right. Make sure you get a conversation in front of Jason.
We definitely don't want to kill anything producing jobs.
We're going to kill your tax base too. If you don't build houses, you don't have a tax base.
The damn government is intruding on everybody's private property, and I'm sick and tired of it.
I am sick of it. We got too much.
That's why I'm on this board for that reason. I'm going to be right with you.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks, Harold.
I'm not running for re-election.
I'm running for anything.
I'm saying it honest out of my heart.
That's true.
I'm not running. I'm not for re-election. I'm...
I just want to work, just like everybody else does, and make a living. So.
You can't run for the county line because you moved it.
Ever moving.
You can go in the other direction. All right, commissioner responses.
Yeah, I'd like to respond respectfully to the comments about 287G. We've been in this for a long time. It's been a long road. It's been a controversial road. And I hope we're not at the end of the road. I hope the road's not getting more narrow. I, as a commissioner, have to be concerned when I see that we're going to be, it's my understanding, $3 million short in projected revenue.
We'll be close, yes, sir.
But you've told me 2, but then I read in Alamance News 3.2, so, we're throwing it around $1 million like it's chump change. And either we're going to be awfully, either we're going to come in awfully under budget, which is, I hope, would be the result of efficiency, or we're going to come in under budget to where we're going to have to take money that could have gone in our fund balance. To balance everything out. When we met with ICE, and I understand things have changed. I'm not that naive to believe that the administration in Washington, that's changed since we got involved. There's been an atmosphere of political correctness on this issue and so forth. It's multifaceted, the arenas that make all this come together. In a positive and or a negative way. When we met with ICE several years ago over here at, what's the name of that building over here? The
Youth Services.
Yeah, Youth Services building. They brought in 2 to 3 people from Charlotte and Atlanta. The woman's card that I've got right here that I want to give to Terry after we get through with our meeting here. I don't want to give her name, but I spoke to her just about 2 weeks ago, 2 to 3 weeks ago, and she's in Atlanta, and she came and met with us here, and she told us then that, it was a mutual agreement that we would have to have with one another, and but that they definitely had different, had a set of priorities, things they wanted to accomplish, and wanted us to be, and or anybody else that signed up with them, wanted each group to be as part of the, big a part of the program as possible and not be very selective in what we did or what they did versus what they wanted. And she said, I'll never forget this, she said transportation was a big part of what they wanted. And I'm sitting back as a commissioner, and I've seen things change from the federal all the way down possibly, as I've always stated, down to the local level. I mean, we were given a big bus from INS. I don't know that we ever used that bus. Did we ever use it?
We never used it.
Why did they bring it and then take it away from us?
Because the changes started to come from the administration in Washington, D.C. They started, give you a good example. Today, where we used to put a person in jail, detain her to be filed for driving while license revoked, no operator's license, they're releasing them on their own recognizance. And the problem we have, we are the only 72-hour holding facility in the state of North Carolina. So if 50 people get caught, say, by Wake County for no operator's license, they're released at Wake and never come to us. And all the counties we were getting people from, not only our 287G people, but were coming from the other counties to us, they're being released on their own recognizance. And I, if you want to come by, I can show you the records mm-hmm. that I pulled off. Released on their own recognizance, and they never get to Alamance County. Mm-hmm. That's exactly why I just recently signed an agreement with ICE for a task force officer working investigations, two of them part-time out in the field, to be able to solve a lot of crimes where they won't be released on their own recognizance, because there'll be serious crimes, drug smuggling, human trafficking, prostitution, et cetera, of immigrants coming into America and coming here. And that's the main reason I did that. What's happened when they're releasing them out here, then our numbers are down here. Theoretically, in calling around, you know, we've got 35 ICE prisoners. That's more than anybody. Mecklenburg County had ICE, had seven, and they were the first 287G site in here.
And we were second.
Yep, we were second. I just want the commissioner to know, I'm trying everything I can to get them here.
Well, and I'm not saying that you're not, other than checks and balances, government. You know, I don't have a vendetta against the department or anything. I'm just saying that I've got to ask my questions. And if my questions appear to be negative or anti our program or anti any individual, I certainly don't mean it that way.
Well, But
let me finish. I called down to Edgewood County in Alabama and spoke to the lady that runs their program there. And she told me their numbers are down. I'll fib to you. She said they were up to about 400. They were double what they were when we went down there. Okay.
Right.
And said they were down to about 300, something, right under 300. So their numbers are different. But by the way, did you know that sheriff has died? Passed away?
I heard that.
Yeah, Sheriff Hayes, I almost fell over.
Worst guy.
He'd gone to hunting and had a heart attack. I couldn't believe that. But I was interested in talking to, not on behalf of our board, but just as an individual, to ask questions, okay? And that's when I called Tom in Raleigh, and Tom said, you need to call, get in touch with this guy in Washington, which you did.
I did.
And this woman here, that he is her supervisor. Okay, she's in Atlanta. She's
the
one
she is,
came
I've
here.
Talked to her. So.
Don't mention her name. Well, you can't. You want to? I'm not going to tell you. She told me 3 weeks ago that she would come here again with the task force and sit down and talk to us and see how much they could do for us, how much we're willing to do for them, and just almost start over again if we want her to come.
Does the first name start with F?
It sure does.
Exactly. Last name
starts with S.
Right.
And so, bottom line is, I would ask, if you will, if our board
I'll be glad to call again. Like I said, I called Mr. GM, talked to him at length. I've talked to her.
But she told me, and this was about 3 weeks ago, she said, in 45 days, I can come up and bring whoever.
I'll be glad. You know, I'll take anything. I'm telling you, I've talked to these people and talked to the people that are assigned to the jail. And the whole problem is the policy changes on the ones that detainers are filed on. Because when it happens to where we getting those that occupy the jail bed space, when we're not getting those because they're releasing on their own recognizance in their own areas where they're being arrested. And I'll tell you right now, 3/4 of them are being released on their own cognizance. Don't never go to court.
Mm-hmm. Of course not.
And they'll be encountered somewhere else. I hope it ain't Alamance County. If it is, I can tell you that.
Well, if this board doesn't have a problem, is it okay if he calls this woman in Atlanta?
Well, let's include that in the agenda item for next month. That's fine. However you want to present it. I just feel uncomfortable having a lengthy discussion without letting the public know that we're talking about it.
I was a little upset. Thursday and Friday, I've calmed down because, you know, We at the sheriff's office, and I'm telling you, is doing everything we possibly can to get those jail beds filled.
What was the deal, just to clear the air and get it off my chest and you get it off yours?
All right.
What was the deal with South Carolina?
We went to South Carolina for 8 months, packed lunches. We didn't carry people down there. We transported people around and back up here because they didn't have the holding facility. Well, the agency come on board with the holding facility, and ICE dropped. Didn't need the transportation contract anymore with us. That's why now we go to
work. So you're saying they cut us off and we didn't?
Yes, sir. We didn't cut them
off. See, I'd always been told that you didn't want to go down there to get them anymore because of the cost difference.
No.
In fact, that's what I thought you told me.
I'll be honest with you. You're right. When I got to figuring the lunches, I said the taxpayers of Alamance County shouldn't pay for lunches for South Carolina inmates. But then I says, well, we'll figure it, and gave us like, I don't know how much more to do that. And we went on down. But I don't see how in the world I can justify going to South Carolina, moving South Carolina inmates and paying Alamance County monies for their lunches. But once I stepped to the up to the plate on that, we did it for about 8 months.
So you're saying they cut us off?
Yes, sir. Okay. That's exactly what I'm saying.
Okay. Because I was told earlier that we cut them off, or we decided we didn't want to do it.
By who?
I thought you did. I thought you told
no,
me.
No, sir. I said I was arguing with them. Mm-hmm. I said I didn't feel like it was fair to take Alamance County taxpayers' money and pay for lunches for South Carolina citizens. But then when I stepped at the plate and said, look, we'll pay X amount more, and they did on transportation contract, we packed bag lunches. And they used the bag lunches. That's how they ate when we were moving them around.
Okay, well, again, rather than have the exchange, I think it'd be better to have a formal presentation on all these aspects.
Well,
let's have it in here.
I don't have any problems with Mr. Sutton on that. I just hope we can understand what's going on. And please, if any commissioner has a problem, come over to my office.
Well, and I would further suggest that we conduct the issue in this courtroom, in this commissioner's room. It was used for a courtroom and not in the media. I think we'd be a whole lot better off. All right, other commissioner comments. Linda, you've got something you'd like to share.
I want to wait till the end.
Oh, you want to do that at the end? Yeah. Okay. Other responses at this time?
I've already gave mine. Maybe at the wrong time, but I gave it.
But you can give it again, right?
I can give it again.
Well, okay.
I don't have anything against public comments.
To Mr. Hargrove's comment there, and we do need to look at that further, figure out what we need to do with that. One of the problems, I think, that brought that up was if you have a fire at a house in the back on that road, the maintenance sometimes is not what it should be, and you're taking a risk also.
You are, but we're living in a real world. We're not living in a world of let's not scratch our fire truck when it goes down a private driveway.
Yeah.
I mean, citizens can't afford these wide roads.
Oh, I know. I know.
Citizens pay for those fire trucks.
Yeah.
Then if they get scratched, that's just part of the game.
That's right. That's my opinion.
As long as they can get to the fire.
That's the point.
Okay, let's move on to item number 6, tax lien advertisement and delinquent account collections. Gerald, come forward, please. Good evening.
Good evening. I hope I don't have anything controversial here this afternoon. We're here to talk about tax lien advertisement. North Carolina General Statute 105-369A requires the tax collector to report to the governing body the total amount of any unpaid taxes for the current fiscal year that are liens on real property. Upon receipt of the report, the governing body must order the tax collector to advertise the tax liens by publishing each lien at least once in a newspaper having general circulation within the county. The advertisement cost is assessed to each real property parcel and is added to the unpaid tax bill. The tax collector has determined that a cost of $5 should be added to each unpaid real property parcel. Bankruptcy law prevents the advertising of the taxes filed under a bankruptcy claim. Therefore, no 2011 tax liens under bankruptcy will be advertised. As of January 31st, 2012, the total amount of liens against real property is $3,889,545.61. The Alamance County Tax Administrator requests the Alamance County Board of Commissioners to approve the lien advertisement of unpaid real property parcels for tax year 2011 at a cost of $5 per parcel. I recommend tax lien advertising on March 14th, 2012 in the Times News and March 15th, 2012 in the Alamance News. And last year we had several questions after the fact. We do half of the townships in the Alamance News and half in the Burlington paper. Total cost last year was around $15,000. The $5 cost assessed each parcel gets all that money back, so the county is not out any money on these advertisements.
Any questions for
Do we need a motion?
We do need a motion.
I'll move that we do that.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion or questions? I have a question. What is the bid that you received on the two papers, Gerald?
We don't get bids on that, Mr. Manning. We submit it, and whatever the column inch cost is, and I'm not sure what it is this year.
I'd like to see that when you get it, please. Because you talk about advertising, how do we know that each parcel is going to be seen by the right person reading the right paper? I don't understand that.
Well, there is no guarantee of that. There's no way to guarantee that. Last year, the legislature talked about going to websites from the newspapers, and they realized that lots of folks don't have computers, don't have access to the website. So they didn't pass that. There's absolutely no way we can ensure that everybody sees those ads. The ad is a first step in pre-foreclosure of the properties. And we know many of these people don't get a newspaper. There's no way to address that. We send everybody a bill, and I brought copies of that for your review. The initial bill is sent in July, and those folks who do not respond on February the 1st or sent a follow-up, which is the second page. And on the back of that second page, it tells you that if you do not pay by February the 29th, 2012, that you will be in the tax lien ad in March.
Well, I understand that. I guess my question is, you're saying you don't put the same information in each paper, though. Is that right?
No, sir. We do half the townships in the Alamance News and half the townships in the Burlington paper. There is nothing that says that we have to use one paper over the other. We did use three newspapers, and in my opinion, we cut out the Mebane Enterprise last year, and that saved us about $1,500. Statutes do not require any certain amount of readership. It just has to have general circulation within the county. Both of these papers have general circulation. We've had no complaints from either paper. The cost is very similar. I think the Burlington paper was about $7,700 last year, and the Alamance News was about $7,200. Cost is similar. The print was a little larger in the Alamance News last year. That was the only real difference.
And you put the same number of parcels in each paper?
Not the exact amount, no, sir. It would be similar, but not. There's no way to do the exact amount doing it by township. One paper gets seven townships. The other one gets six.
Okay. Well, I would like to see the figures when you get them all compiled. All right, we have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, Gerald.
I would like to bring it to your attention. The amount that is right now, we have liens now, as of today, of $3,113,000.
Down from this $3,008,000?
Yes, sir. Last year at this same time, it was $4,040,000. And in February 10, it was $4,577,000. So our collections unit is making great progress, and I'm very proud of their efforts. I think they're doing an excellent job for the taxpayers of the county.
What is it like by the time we get to August or September based on those?
By the time we get to August, it'll be down to less than $2 million. And then by the next year, we'll collect another 90-some percent of that. Once our accounts get over about 3 years old, we'll have collected about 99.9% of the real property. The real property is not a problem. After 10 years, we write them off, and we're usually down to $30,000 or $40,000 on real property out of $55 million.
Yeah.
So that's pretty good rate, I think. The only thing we have problems with is registered motor vehicles. And we'll collect about 88% of that per year, and then over the following years we'll collect some more of that, but we never get to 99.9% of registered motor vehicles, transits, move in and out of state, that sort of thing.
But if we got the tax when they got their renewal tag, we'd get it all, right?
Yes, sir. And that was supposed to have happened in July of 2009, and it didn't happen. It was supposed to happen in July of 2011. It didn't happen. And now House Bill 1779 is supposed to come into effect in July of 2013. I'm a doubter. So,
well, but you guys are doing great.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Gerald.
Thank you.
Item 7, dissolution and resolution of the Alamance Caswell LME. Welcome, Clyde Albright.
Hello, hello. Good evening.
As you know, the General Assembly of the State of North Carolina has required that all LMEs merge if they're under a certain catchment area. And we fell below that level when Rockingham County left, and we've been trying to merge for the last several years. By joint resolution of the boards of the county commissioners of Alamance and Caswell County last year, and in compliance with General Assembly Law 2011-264, PBH was created, and we were asked to, the terminology was merge. Now we know it's dissolve into PBH, effective October 1st, 2011. We have obtained approval from the Department of Health and Human Services in Raleigh to dissolve. Assistant Secretary Beth Melcher has indicated the state will approve the dissolution of the ACLME in accordance with 122C, 115.3B, as that statute is amended by this session law 211-264. Now the next step is for the Board of the County Commissioners in Alamance County and in Caswell County to assure themselves that the continuity of mental health services has been achieved. I think we can assure ourselves of that. They've been provided by PBH since October 1st of last year. What remains to be done is adopt a dissolution resolution, which you have before you there. Caswell County must also vote, and they're going to do adopt the similar resolution that the Caswell County attorney and I have developed together. Then following that, the ACLME must hold a public hearing with notice published in the newspaper to let consumers know that the PBH is now providing the services, and there will be a winding down process. And the board in this resolution, you as the board are appointed as the oversight committee along with the Caswell board to make sure that services are continuing to be provided to our citizens. Do you have any questions?
Questions for Clyde?
Number one, I'd like to mention that the chairman of the board is here. David Carter is here with us tonight.
Welcome.
Where does the board, have they voted to dissolve this? How does that work?
The state law that was passed last June requires that the area authority be dissolved when the minimum population falls below.
Okay.
And PBH was created as this Medicaid waiver LME, and we were instructed to merge with them, Caswell and Alamance, along with five other counties, Union, Stanley. I've got the list here.
Well, actually, but and Linda might respond to this. The board, the LME. had to merge. Now, who they had to merge with was up for discussion, and they did look at several different entities before David, before settling on PBH. So yes, by that, the PBH board welcomed this LME effective October.
We're talking about dissolving it right now.
We're talking about dissolving what was the umbrella agency, which is now under PBH, which is out of Concord. Mm-hmm. And they have, David, what are their other counties that they manage?
They have five counties up there, and then Alamance and Caswell, and then the next ones to come on will be Orange, Person, and Chatham, and then there's, I think, five more counties up in the northern part that are all slated to come on by June or July of this year, making them somewhere around a 17-county entity.
Basically, I think the state encouraged with this threshold of consolidation among the local LMEs.
The counties are Cabarrus, Caswell, Davidson, Rowan, Stanley, Union, and Alamance. And then they're looking at Orange, Pearson, and Chatham.
Okay.
So is it standard that the commissioner board dissolve it prior to the PB, the local LME that was in place, or
what we have done?
I don't know enough about it, so maybe you can tell me about it.
What we have done, the state has said go ahead and effect a merger, and so PBH did that on October 1st.
Okay.
So they've been providing all the services to the consumers. There's no lapse in service, but now the ACLME has nothing to do.
Okay.
And so the statute says, and they amended the statute to specifically state that when the air authority doesn't meet the minimum population requirements, they may dissolve at any time. So what Beth Melcher and the North Carolina Attorney General's office is telling me is, now that we've got the merger with PBH, and I hate to keep saying merger, but that's what I thought it was, they're telling me now it's a dissolution. So once that has taken effect and the consumers are being provided services, there's no need for the ACLME to continue. So they will dissolve.
Maybe we should call it a combination.
Right. And three of their, we're on their board now, PBH's board.
Yeah,
so there's a continuity of service.
This board last meeting in the consent agenda approved for David Carter and John Moon and myself as the commissioner rep to be represented on the PBH board.
Right.
Now, the other thing that will happen is there will be a local advisory board.
That's correct.
That David will learn about and bring information and form that board with concurrence of PBH. When you say there's nothing left to do, there are still some loose ends that David's been diligently working on with his board in terms of getting some documentation out and transferring some funds to the county and so forth. But yeah, this is the instrument that officially says, and Caswell, this is the same thing Caswell's going to do.
Same thing Caswell is going to do. Brian Farrell and I drafted that together.
So it's part of the, and Clyde used the word wind down process.
Okay. Well, I got one more question because I noticed in the paper a while back about the compromising computer and all that stuff. Have we resolved that issue with the LME?
That is a federal HIPAA issue. Mm-hmm. 60 days after there was a concern of a HIPAA breach, the investigation should have been completed by the 15th of January. And publication at that point should have been put in the newspaper. And I don't know if the Alamance Caswell LME published it. The PBH published something. But that is a federal issue now.
Yeah.
And remains to be seen what they're going to do.
Chair, could we get David to speak? I mean, he was part of this.
Would you like to speak?
An agenda item. And
sure.
I mean, he's antsy over there, and I'd like to hear what he's got to say about it.
Don't go far, because we need a motion here in a few minutes. Yeah.
Well, first of all, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, thank you for appointing me and allowing me to represent Alamance and County there at PBH. I don't disagree with most of what Mr. Albright has said. However, I would like to give a little bit more details. I'm not an attorney, and I'm sort of learning in this process as I go with laws and things. The information that I have and is given to us comes from the Department of Health and Human Services, along with the general statutes and the North Carolina School of Government. Basically, from our perspective, while the LME board cannot dissolve itself as of yet, is what you brought up, primarily the main reason, the breach, or waiting on the analysis from National Digital Forensics to take place. I know Mr. Albright referred to having that done by January 15th. However, when they first came and wanted to start that initial investigation, he was not present to sign the continuation of, I forget what they call that document, but anyway, it's a legal document that he needed to sign or appoint someone to sign, and he was not there, and nor could we get anyone appointed. So they were here that whole day basically for nothing, and I think that was somewhere along the end of November. And then we had to reschedule a second appointment for them to come, which pushed the initial investigation further back. And obviously, and I've been asked by some of you this question, why have they not responded as quickly and as diligently maybe as you think that they should? They are based out of Raleigh. They had they handle federal cases, Department of Justice cases, law enforcement cases, and unless we're going to pony up a lot of money to just secure them for us only, they're going to obviously work with us as they have an opportunity. And they have. When they came back on the second time, Mr. Honeycutt was there to represent the county and to sign the documents, and he did sign those documents to begin that initial evaluation. That they were here for 3 days, a week and a half ago. There was an enormous amount of servers and things they have to look at and do. We did put a call in today to find out where they stand on that issue, and we have not received a call back from them today, which is not uncommon because I don't know how big their office is, but they're in the field a lot, and so they do respond to us as they have time and do get back in touch with us about that. After that issue is resolved, and how that is resolved is, and we hope there's no issue there, and they come back and say there's no issue, then that is presented by National Digital Forensic of Raleigh to our current LME board, and then we accept that information back, and then we can proceed forward with the dissolution of the LME, which requires several things, some of which Mr. Albright mentioned, some that he did not. We have to, number one, file a public notice in Alamance and Caswell County, not just Alamance, but in Caswell County. I believe, and like I said, I'm not an attorney, but I believe 10 days after that, we have to have a public hearing in both counties. So that notice has to run in newspapers in both counties, and then the public hearing also has to take place in both counties. After that, there's a third notice that has to be published by the ACLME board to dissolve the board as well, and there's a public hearing from the LME board in addition to that. So three public notices, three hearings. At the conclusion of that, then the board would meet again to officially dissolve itself, and I'm told that is the only way we can do this. Per the general statute, the board has to dissolve itself, and then in completion of that, then we turn over all the money and remainder things to Alamance County. And so we don't see any problems, hopefully, coming down this timeline. Can it be done by middle of March? I hope so, but I'm not in control of all these issues and filing of the public notices and facilitating those and getting on schedules in respective counties and making sure that happens.
David, are you suggesting any reason that we should table this until we get further down in that road?
I would respectfully, as the board chair of that board, I think that it would speak highly of the commissioners if they would do that. There's certainly nothing wrong with that document. You have all right to vote on it and accept it. I think what Mr. Albright has done is put something in front of your hands, tangible, that you can see, and that's certainly fine. Like I said, there are additional things that probably should be included in that or added to that. I would suggest that he work with our attorney and try to develop that. I know that's a difficulty thing sometimes, but respectfully, I think there's a right way of doing this, and your predecessors or maybe some of you appointed some of us to this board. The only other way I see this happening is you basically fire all of us and find somebody else to take this at the end of the game and try to do it. And I'm trying to keep them together just to finish this. There, and if there's a question from the public, and this was brought up the other day, is there a conflict of interest or anything with our board members, especially myself serving on PBH and this? The LME is not making any money. The old LME that you know that you appointed us to is not making any money. It's not running any services. It's not doing anything. For all practicality, it is just a shell to finish the audit. And as he mentioned, PBH did take over services October 1st. They're running top-notch, smooth from what I understand. However, there is an audit that will run from October the 1st till this is finalized, and that will be another thing in addition to this that our board would have to find and accept as well. So a few things like that. If there are anything else that comes up, filing of any legal lawsuits or anything like that, obviously the board would have to look at that, but we hope that doesn't take place. We hope we can just, trust me, we don't want to keep running this thing out. There's not one member of that board that wants to keep dragging this out. They want to be done with it. So
Clyde, is there any reason we can't hold off on this?
Well, according to the State Attorney General and Ms. Melcher, the board should go ahead and dissolve the LME because it's no longer functioning as an LME. PBH is functioning as the LME. And then the winding down process follows, where the assets, whatever remain, are paid over to the county. As you know, under our interlocal agreement, we're due some money on that to provide medical insurance for the retirees of the LME. Doesn't look like there's going to be enough money to do that. So if there are any assets left, it would behoove this board to go ahead dissolve the LME and begin the winding down process. Now, that's the word I'm getting from the AG's office.
Well, it sounds to me, and I'm a representative on the LME board, as you know, that there's still enough, I won't call it disagreement, but maybe misunderstanding slash lack right. of communication, that I would suggest that we defer this till the first meeting in March, and in that, make sure you and David and the LME attorney sit down and talk and get a game plan where these differences of opinion can be resolved by that time.
Well, and with respect, I don't have a problem with doing that. I don't mind contacting Mrs. Melcher as well. I don't think that the Department of Health and Human Services would like for us to dissolve while this breach is ongoing, because then who's going to handle that issue? And we started that. We had to vote on that, and I don't think that you guys can do that. I think that has to be our board that handles that, and I don't mind contacting her. And Raleigh's aware of this, as so is the feds, because we did have to file the notice of the possibility of, we did file a notice of a breach, and we're waiting for that analysis. So that is the main reason that we see that we can't just dissolve and turn this over to you guys. We're trying to help you finish this off, hopefully, so keeps you guys from having to deal with this mess.
I understand what you're saying, David. Is the board comfortable in asking these two parties to get together and bring it back in March?
Yeah, I still not
legally,
totally.
Tell us legally what it's going to cost the county if we put this off. Or is it going to be to our advantage not to put it off illegally?
Just another few weeks of liability lying out there. I would suggest following the directive of the Attorney General and the Department of Health and Human Services. If this breach issue is an issue, it's not a private right of action. It's statutory. 60 days after you suspect a breach, there's a 60-day period that starts clicking on the clock. And within that period of time, you must decide whether you're going to report a breach.
When does that 60 days end?
The 15th of January.
So it's over anyhow. It's already passed anyhow.
Can I give you some clarification as to that? That 60 days was in reference to when we have to notify the Department of Health and Human Services of the breach.
Right.
We did do that. We tried to handle this, obviously, the best way that we could before we got to that point. And so we didn't wait because we didn't have anything better to do. We were waiting to try to handle the situation. We did file it in the necessary time frame of the 60 days. We do have documentation and proof of that. We are dealing with the feds on this currently, on the HIPAA breach, and we are dealing with Raleigh on it. They're very much aware of the situation. They're giving us the green flag saying we're doing everything right, and these things that I mentioned to you that I stated we have to accomplish and do, that's coming from those departments. So with respect, I don't mind talking to Ms. Melcher, but I don't know that, once again, our information is lining up as you're talking about. Maybe all three of us need to get together, our attorney, Mr. Albright, myself, and contact Raleigh as to what his proposal is, if we can do that. And if we can do that, I have no problem with doing that, but I'm told that we can't at this point because of the breach.
Is our next meeting 2 weeks from tonight?
Yes, sir.
I don't think 2 weeks is going to make any difference. When's the last time you talked to Mr. Paisley?
Probably January.
Okay. I would suggest that before 2 weeks from tonight, that the LME attorney and our attorney sit down with you and get a game plan. And I'm troubled that there's still no communication between the two attorneys. I'm troubled.
And I can do that if Mr. Albright's in agreement. We can make that happen.
Sure.
Let's do that. Is that all right with everybody?
I'm good.
Tim, you all right with that?
Yeah.
Yes, I'm all right with this biggest mess I've ever seen in my life, I'll tell you that.
Well, let's do that. So we'll table this for 2 weeks, but I would like for the LME attorney to come that night as well. And having had a game plan with our attorney, with you as the facilitator.
Absolutely, and I invited him to be here tonight, but he had a medical procedure today and could not be here, so I apologize.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. We're just going to table it. Do we need to vote to table it? We need to vote to table?
Well, that make it simple.
I'll make a motion that we table this to our meeting in March, meeting in March.
You okay with that? Bill,
I'm going to vote against it.
Okay. Is there a second?
If the attorney says it's all right, and if you think it's advisable,
it's not going to hurt anything, at least in my opinion.
Okay, that's good enough for me. Okay.
Any other discussion, questions? All in favor of the motion, which is to table this discussion and contract proposal for 2 weeks. And at that time, the LME attorney, our attorney, and you mind coming back, Mr. Carter?
Yes, sir.
We'll present it again. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. We have 4 budget amendments from the Health Department. Barry, welcome.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Commissioner. I guess I would like to start off by saying I hope Gerald brings in that $3 million.
We hope he does.
He's on his way.
On his way.
We're pulling for him. All righty. The first amendment that I have before you all tonight is infectious disease control. These are training monies that come down from the state of North Carolina that will allow us to do like some of our infection control education work. As you all may have heard, we've had some issues within the last couple of months regarding norovirus and pertussis, so this will aid us in terms of training our staff in order to keep up with those diseases and how we best manage them, their control. So I would ask the board's consideration that we accept these $2,440.
Is there any reason we can't present all 4 of these and vote once, or does the board want to take them individually?
We normally do.
I know we normally do, but is there any reason we have to?
No, there's a couple on here I got some questions about, but
okay, let's do it individually then. Although, is there a motion for amendment? This is 97.
Yes, so moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
I didn't vote aye. There's an aye.
Not voting is an aye, I learned. Okay, Barry, what's number 98?
I believe number 98 has to do with our centering pregnancy grant that we got from the March of Dimes. And we actually, these funds came in terms of a calendar year. So what we're apportioning out of 60% of those funds between now and the end of the current state county fiscal year. And we're asking to accept $17,422. You all have supported our centering pregnancy program for the last 2 years. So these funds will go to support the part of the position of our coordinator, as well as other costs related back to that program for supplies, materials. And this is an evidence-based best practice in terms of taking care of our pregnant women. So I would ask your consideration to accept the funding.
This is budget amendment number 98. Is there
a
motion?
That's the one I had a question about. I'm okay.
I'll make a motion that we approve that.
Thank you, Bill. Any other discussion on this one, 98? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Number 99.
Number 99 is in this amount of $1,370. And this is a grant allocation for the University of North Carolina School of Medicine. And this is supporting a breastfeeding collaboration that we are working with them to encourage our ladies to breastfeed. This fits, again, is kind of a collaborative with our WIC program, Hand in Glove, to support those activities in the university in terms of doing research about the efficacy of breastfeeding. So we ask your consideration to accept these funds. And this is, again, from UNC, and would go towards the support of our administrative support and staff position that keeps track on this program for us.
Is there a motion to approve the ECHO pilot grant?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you, Linda and Eddie. Any discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? And number 100.
Yes, sir. This is in the amount of $2,240, and this is from the Division of Public Health to go towards supporting sterilization. We could use it for any kind of a family planning related. So we've used these, again, in terms of trying to support permanent birth control for some folks who are willing to do this for either female sterilizations or for vasectomies. Usually goes to the females, but we could go either way if we have men step up and do that. So anyway, these funds do go to support. We want to use it towards those particular activities.
Make a motion to approve.
Thank you, Eddie. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Thank you, Linda. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Thank you, Barry. Thanks, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
County Manager reports. Craig?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just wanted to mention one thing. I know there was discussion about Jason. Jason has had some health issues, and he was out of pocket all of last week, but he should be here tomorrow. So he's doing much better. So I do apologize if anybody's tried to get in touch with him and he was out of pocket, but he's doing much better. And that's all I have.
Yeah, he actually, while he was out, made it clear that he was available by phone and admired him
for that. So
detail.
Some of the answers that have been brought up here, right. Some of the questions brought up here tonight will have answers.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Craig. Commissioner comments.
Uh-huh.
Linda, I know you want to share.
I'm on the Piedmont Triad Regional Council, and at our meeting this past week, Wednesday, we voted, this was the whole board, not just the executive board, I'm on that too, but we voted to build a building. It's going to be at Carrollton Crossing. I have no idea. It's in Kernersville somewhere. And Mr. Honeycutt was there. And this building, the total cost is going to be $4 million for this building, but it's 2,500 square feet. That seems like a whole lot, though. 25,000, I'm sorry. 25,000 square feet, yeah. Yeah, but that still seems like a whole lot for 25,000 square feet. You know, usually we look at $100 a square foot, don't we? But anyway, I just want everybody to know that that's what was voted on. And I gave you a list of all the other options, the lease options here. So I won't read all those, but this is the one that was chosen, was to build a building and to purchase the property.
So. And Linda, the council itself is the result of a merger, is it not?
Yes. It's a 12 county. Okay. Did I not give you one?
No,
maybe not. Yeah, you got one.
Okay.
Yeah, this is a 12 county. We just merged with five other counties, and I don't know all the names of them either. So.
But my understanding was that the current facilities, which are under rent or lease, the leases will go out. So actually, this will be a lower.
Yes, both of them were being leased.
Cost.
Yeah, both of them were being leased, and it's going to save them quite a bit of money.
It's positive cash flow.
Yeah, it's going to be. It's going to save us quite a bit of money on that. So. Anyway, I just wanted to give that back to the board.
Thank you, Linda. Mm-hmm. Any questions for Linda about the Piedmont Triad Regional Council? That's a form of what was the Triad Council of Governments.
Where's that at, Kearns? I'm over at the line. I'm going to look at that.
Carol.
It's a new development. I'm not sure.
It's off of 40.
It's
off 40, Ken. But I don't know exactly.
I think
where.
Everything in Kernersville is off of 40.
Yeah. I think so.
Well, no, you go down 60. No, you can go another way, and it ain't on 40.
Everything's off. Is it over there at that Catholic high school?
I don't have a clue. They didn't take us over.
What's the name of that high school? Yeah, Bishop. Yeah.
They didn't take us over.
Is that where it is?
Are you familiar?
Of course, amazing.
Any other commissioner comments?
Mr. Chair, I'd like to recognize we have two school board guests with us.
We do. Tony Rose and Patsy Simpson. Good to see y'all.
Mm-hmm.
Any other comments? I just have the sales tax report that we all receive, and I want to point out that it is encouraging. The sales tax figures are through November. I keep learning about how we distribute this. The information we get is on a 60-day?
Lag.
Yes, sir. So we don't have, we have part of the holiday sales, but we don't have December yet. But through November, sales tax, which includes, I guess, a full year of Tanger now, 11-12 fiscal year, it's up about 11%, 17% just for the month of November, which is encouraging. But for the year to date, it looks like about 11.5% increase on sales tax for the prior year. So that's certainly positive. And money-wise, that translates into about $1.3 million. So if December was good and we can keep it going, maybe we'll get a little revenue in here.
Yes, sir.
So,
sounds good.
Okay, well, if there are no more comments, we stand adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster.com. at alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.